October the 16th, 1996, the survivor is Hilda Pierce, morning Harper interviewed in Laguna Niguel, California, USA. It will be in English.
My name is Maureen, that's M-A-U-R-E-E-N, Halpert, H-A-L, P as in Paul, E-R-T. I'm interviewing today Hilda Pierce. It's October 16th, 1996. We are in Laguna Niguel. The language is English. Can you give me your full name and spell it for me, please?
Hilda Pierce, H-I-L-D-A. P-I-E-R-C-E.
Can you give me your name at birth and spell that for me, please?
It's Hilda Hertha Harmel, H-I-L-D-A, second name H-E-R-T-H-A, last name H-A-R-M-E-L.
Have you used any other names?
Yes, my first married name was Reuben. And
can you spell that, please?
R-U-B-I-N.
Have you used any nicknames at all?
Yes. My husband calls me Heidi.
And spell that, please.
H-E-I-D-I.
And do you have a Hebrew name?
Yes, Esther. E-S-T-H-E-R.
What city and country were you born in? Spell that, please.
Yeah, I was born in Vienna, Austria. V-I-E-N-N-A. In German, it's spelled W-I-E-N. And Austria, A-U. S-T-R-I-A.
What date were you born?
July 8th, 1921.
And how old are you today?
75.
Tell me again, where were you born?
I was born in Vienna.
Okay. And tell me about your parents. What were their names?
My mother's name is Evelyn, and my father's name Julius Harmel, H-E-R-M-E-L, and my mother was born in a little town outside of Vienna, but my father was born in Vienna.
Where was your mother born? What town?
It's called Lasse, L-A-S-S-E-E.
Did you have any brothers or sisters?
No, I'm an only child.
What did your father do for work?
My father was an art appraiser and antique dealer. That was his profession after I was born. Before that, he worked for the Austrian government.
What did he do?
He was actually worked for a traffic direction. He directed traffic of trains all over Austria. A traffic manager, I guess we call it.
What about your mother? Did she work?
We had two stores. My father had an antique store, and my mother had a textile store, like a fabric shop.
Did she have people working for her?
Yes, they had employees, both of them.
How many?
I don't remember, two, three each, and that changed over the years. And I really was raised by maids and cooks and household help, because both my parents were always working.
Tell me about your home. What was it like?
We had an apartment in a big apartment building that was sort of a court arrangement. The building surrounded a large courtyard where all the children that lived in the building played. And it was in the fourth district of Vienna. Vienna was divided into districts, and the fourth district was called the diplomatic center. So all the various consulates were in that district. And we lived almost at the edge of a palace called the Prince Eugene Belvedere, which had a beautiful garden and park where we used to go and play.
What was the inside of your home like? Can you tell me about that?
Well, it was like a two-bedroom apartment. And the only thing that was different was the heating method. We had what was called a Kachelofen. That's a big stove built with tiles. And it looked like a castle sitting in the corner. And Everything else was just like an American apartment, except the building was old. It was built, I would imagine, in the 1900s, early 1900s.
Tell me about your grandparents.
Of course, I had two sets of grandparents, except my paternal grandparents died when I was 1 and 3 years old. My grandfather was in the same business as my father, and my grandmother was a housewife because my father was one of 11 children, and so she was busy. Of course, they didn't all survive. And my maternal grandparents lived in the small town, Lassay, that I mentioned before, where my grandfather was a what you would call a gentleman farmer. He owned a lot of land, and it was farmed. And during the First World War, my mother was in charge of 80 Russian prisoners of war that worked on the land because all the Austrian men had to go to war. So they had these prisoners of war come to work for them.
Was your father in the First World War?
Yes. And my mother's brother and my father's brothers and, well, everybody in the family, because they took everybody. And, of course, Austria lost the war, was chopped up, and from a fairly large country of 64 million population, it then became a very tiny country with just this over large big city of Vienna with this tiny little country behind it of only 6 million total. And there was great starvation because there was no food in the country. It was a mountainous country and they couldn't grow any food. The only place that was flat where they had food was where my grandfather had the farm, which was right along the Danube, going toward the Czech border.
Did you see any starvation?
Yes, at home we were very well off because my mother and I took the train to the farm every week and brought home suitcases full of food. But my mother and father took me to the outskirts of Vienna to show me where people were living in holes dug in the ground, and with just cardboard to cover up the hole. They were so poor and starving. And the veterans came back without limbs, sitting on the street begging in tattered uniforms. They couldn't be taken care of. I mean, it was terrible. And I used to be allowed to invite the children home for dinner because we had meat and they never saw meat. So, even I, although I was well-fed, had rickets as a child because we didn't have any fresh fruit in the winter. So there was great starvation after the war.
What were your grandparents' names?
My grandfather, Moses Aaron Harmel, and my grandmother, Rosa Harmel. And my other grandparents were Therese Kohn, and my grandfather, Adolf Kohn.
Tell me about religious life.
Well, both sides, both my grandparents had kosher households. My father was a non-practicing Jew. And I had no religious life at home, except that we were invited to seders at my aunt's house every year. And I had a religious instruction at school. Austria, being a Catholic country, was very observant of religious beliefs, and a Catholic priest came to class every day and taught catechism, and I was the only Jewish child in the school, so I was allowed to stay in the room and just had to sit in the back row. And I was a very bright child, and I knew all the answers, and I was forever raising my arm and wanted to answer the question, and the priest always says, "You keep quiet."
Did you have seders at home? Or?
No. We went to my relatives for seder.
So how would you describe yourself?
I'm also a non-practicing Jew, but very aware of the fact that I'm Jewish and very interested in Jewish causes.
What languages did you speak at home?
German.
Did you speak any other?
At school we had French. I had French, Italian, and English at school.
What was the relationship like between you and your parents?
Extremely close. Extremely close.
What type of things would you do together?
Well, every Sunday when the stores were not open, we would go to museums in the winter. Every single Sunday my father took me to the various museums. And all of Vienna was like a museum because the Baroque architecture and the churches and the buildings were very interesting. And in the summer, we'd go hiking in the Vienna woods and have picnics and have a rucksack, which is a backpack, and eat Wiener Schnitzel and Gurkensalat, which is a veal, breaded veal cutlet and cucumber salad.
What was the city of Vienna like?
It was not as beautiful as it is now because it was all black and sooty and sort of dismal. It was after the war, so there was that much poverty. People couldn't afford to paint their houses or do anything on the streets, and it was dismal. It was also torn by so much political strife, and from the time I was 6 years old, I was very interested in politics. Not only me, all the other children were too, because we were practicing with gas masks in the first grade. We learned how to put out incendiary bombs. There were revolutions and putsches and civil war and all kinds of strife. So it was a very interesting childhood. And Hitler came in. I mean, we had so many. We had Chancellor assassinated in the Parliament. That was Dollfuss, the very short chancellor.
Tell me about that.
Well, all I know is that he was assassinated by someone who disguised himself as a cleaning person and assassinated him. And then his heir was a young man who used to be Minister of Education by the name of Kurt von Schuschnigg, whom I subsequently met at a cocktail party in Highland Park, Illinois. And Schuschnigg was head of a, Austria was a republic after the war, and it was a social democratic republic. It's not socialist in the sense of socialist here, it was social democratic, which was milder. It was to the left, but not as far left as a socialist. After Dollfuss was assassinated and Schuschnigg came in, Austria became Christian socialists, which was the religious right.
When was that?
I would say maybe 35, 36. And my father, who held many honorary positions, he had a card printed at one time where he was president or board member of 26 different organizations, including his professional organization, the Dealers of Antiques. And when Schuschnigg came in, he got one letter after the other kicking him out of all his jobs because he was Jewish. And the rumblings of National Socialism came long before the Anschluss. I would say starting in 1935, I noticed it among my friends. There was whispering. They were wearing white stockings and blue cornflowers, which was the sign of National Socialism. And you could tell. There were all kinds of underground movements, and it was clear to me as a child of 14 or 13 that it wasn't going to be long before Hitler would get into Austria, but my father was in total denial.
I'd like to go back a little bit and find out, firstly, so you said you went to a synagogue. Do you recall the name of it or the rabbi? Or?
Yes, it was a synagogue in the 10th district, and it was called the Humboldt Temple. And I think the name of the rabbi was Mandel.
What was school like? Tell me about school, the relationship with other children.
Grammar school was very close to our house, and it was an easy walk. I was very happy at school. There were no other Jewish children in my class at the time. But grammar school was only 4 years. After 4 years, you went either to a public high school, which was 4 years, or to a semi-public high school, which was then 8 years, and that was called gymnasium. And for that, the parents had to pay very little, but they had to pay. And I went to what was called a Real Gymnasium, which specialized in mathematics, geometry, and was really for engineers, which was not my forte particularly, because I was much more artistic than mathematically inclined. But I went there, and it was a long streetcar ride, 3 streetcars. At the age of 10, I had to go into what was then considered bad traffic and change streetcars 3 times to go to school. That's how far away it was. There were 2 other Jewish girls in my class. And the professors were very strict, and there was a lot of homework. And I think I enjoyed it. I don't really remember that I was unhappy. I was a very good student and sort of a goody-goody. And I was very strictly brought up. And my parents insisted that I excel in school. Because I was weak in math, I had a tutor at the age of 10 in math in order to get top grades, because they insisted that I study hard.
How did the other students treat you that weren't Jewish?
Very well at first, until the political situation became such that they took sides. And we would go to major rallies in Vienna, let's say on the 1st of May, which was the workers' Labor Day. And instead of singing the Austrian anthem, they would put the words of the German anthem in, because it was the same tune. The music was the same of the German anthem and the Austrian. So they exchanged the word. Instead of singing about Austria, they sang about Deutschland, Deutschland über alles. And then they took sides, and there was whispering, and I was discriminated against in games and in sports. I was very good at certain sports, and they wouldn't pick me as a captain or whatever. And it was very apparent that there was a lot of discrimination.
When did this start?
I think when I was about 12.
So this was, what year was this then?
Well, it was 33, 34. When Hitler first came into Germany, and this was the underground movement, they didn't really expect any reunification of the Third Reich at that time yet, but they were inclined to be very anti-Semitic.
What were your goals as a young child?
And I always wanted to be an artist, that was the only goals I had, and I was very interested in children's groups that my parents put me into to fight against ever having another war.
What
and we sang songs about never having war again.
What groups were they, and how old were you?
Well, I was in different groups, like summer camps, and always through the Social Democratic Party. My father felt it was important that I mingle with the workers' children rather than just the elite. And those were the groups. And we were indoctrinated that war is a terrible thing and that we should fight against it. And let the big shots fight among themselves and not involve the people, because we suffered so much in the war, and we were taught that the Versailles Treaty was very unfair, which of course history has proven so. And we were all extremely politically aware, all the children, like I said, from age six on. We didn't know football scores, but we knew about politics.
What were your friends like?
I had close friends in my building where I lived. We had a group of children that played in this courtyard, and all but two became ardent Nazis. And the terrible thing was when Hitler marched into Austria, they brought out their uniforms, they had uniforms, and these young boys and girls would spit on me. They were my best friends, and wouldn't talk to me, and wouldn't, like I said, spit at me and throw stones, and it was terrible.
What would you do?
Well, what could you do? First you try to talk to them, and then your parents tell you that if you talk back, you're going to get killed. So you don't talk back, you just evade them or avoid them and walk past fast. And that's all you can do. But it was so pervasive, and nobody can really imagine what it is like when the national policy becomes it becomes stylish to be nasty to your old friends. They want to, in the parks, there were benches where you couldn't sit. On the street, you couldn't take certain forms of transportation. And it goes right to the very center of your being.
When did you start to see this?
Well, I saw it even before Hitler marched into Austria, long before. I would go to a movie with some friends, and you'd see hordes of young people marching, singing the Horst Wessel song, you know, when the Jewish blood spurts from knives. And this was going on for at least 2 years before.
What did you enjoy doing as a child in your spare time? Or growing up, what were
there was hobbies? No spare time. We had no spare time. We had school, we had after-school activities, dance classes, ice skating classes, horseback riding classes. There was no spare time. And what spare time there was, I would go to the various stores that my parents had and do my homework.
What was the first thing that you saw that affected you for the anti-Semitism?
Well, I just told you, this was years, and my aunt and uncle, my father's sister and their son, left in 1934 for what was then Palestine. They saw it coming. They tried to get their money out. They lost two-thirds of their fortune by doing that, because it was not legal to take any money out of Austria. And I begged my father to do that too, and he wouldn't. He called my uncle the Meshuggene Max, you know, the crazy Max, because he did that and lost so much money. And then my aunt came to visit from Palestine, crying bitterly how she hated it there, and how hot it was, and how terrible it was, and my cousin didn't like it, and she didn't want to go back. My father forcibly had to push her back on the train to take the ship back to Israel, which was then Palestine. They lived in Haifa.
What were their names?
Their name was Felman, and my aunt Adele, and my uncle Max, and my cousin Fritz, and they're all dead.
What was it like when Hitler became Chancellor of Germany in 1933?
Well, I saw him march into Vienna, and I was on the Ringstrasse, which is the main thoroughfare in Vienna. It rings the inner city. And I saw thousands of people fall to their knees and greeting him with flowers and with kisses, and there seemed to be no ill will. He was welcomed with open arms. Although Schuschnigg made a speech as Hitler was crossing the border. But it was all arranged beforehand because Schuschnigg, the chancellor, had gone to Berchtesgaden. There was a meeting there, and Schuschnigg had to accept a Nazi into his government in Vienna. His name was Seyss Inquart, and that was sort of a quisling. And it was all arranged. The Anschluss was all arranged beforehand. Schuschnigg was very weak, and he couldn't resist because he didn't expect or get any help from the from England or France. We had hoped that in the last minute somebody would come to our aid, but nobody did.
How did it affect you in 1933?
Well, it affected me that we got thrown out of school, that the people that owed my father money in the stores, nobody paid. Everybody took merchandise, bought it, and never paid. We desperately tried to get out. I tried to get out. A couple of my friends and I spent every single day going from one consulate to another to try to find a way of getting out and find out the regulations that you had to follow to get a visa to another country. We found out that you couldn't come to America, which was my first choice, because I thought that Broadway was paved with gold, and there was a dollar prince waiting for me at every corner, and I was looking for that. And my parents were going to go to Israel to join my father's sister, and I also had an uncle in Alexandria, Egypt, and they tried to get my parents to get to Israel, but in order to do that, they had to go to Cyprus first. So my aunt from Israel and my uncle from Alexandria went to Cyprus to arrange for my parents to go to Cyprus.
I'm going to stop right here. We're going to be going on to the next tape. Thank you. We were talking about 1933 and Hitler becoming Chancellor of Germany. What were the first things that you actually saw when that happened? We were discussing that.
There were placards on buildings with excerpts of a newspaper called The Stürmer, which was a newspaper edited by a man by the name of Streicher that had very, very nasty cartoons about Jews and terrible anti-Semitic slurs, and they were enlarged three stories high and pasted onto sides of buildings. And well, that was really the first thing. Then there were all kinds of marches. Austria had something like 47 different political parties, and they were always having marches and torch light parades and things like that. And of course, during the Civil War, the various factions were actually shooting at each other, and we had martial law, and we were locked into our apartments and couldn't get out, and we didn't have any water, we didn't have any electricity. I mean, and then they burnt the Palace of Justice down. I mean, it was constant strife.
When was that?
I don't know all the dates anymore,
okay, sure.
But I would say from 1934 on.
What did you know about Hitler?
Well, we heard a lot about it, but it was all rumors. We didn't really know as much as we should have known. Or we read a lot in the paper, and we didn't believe it. We didn't want to believe it. We heard about German Jewish refugees came into Austria and told stories, and we felt sorry for them, and my father donated money toward them and all that. But we didn't believe that anything could happen like the death camps. We really didn't believe that. We heard about people getting shoeboxes full of ashes from their relatives. And of course, then after Hitler came, my uncles were arrested. My father had to constantly hide. The janitor of our building was kindly disposed toward him, and he would come into the store and he said, "Hey, they're coming, the uniformed SS or the SA men would come." So my father would run out the back door and hide, and things like that. I mean, you could hardly not notice it. And there were constant stories about a cousin having been beaten at school. He was going to medical school, and he was beaten at the university. And people tried to cross the border and were caught and came back. And there's so many stories that you just couldn't miss it.
Tell me about the laws.
There was fear, and I only tried to get out. That was my big stress. You know, that was my hobby, to try to get myself out of Austria.
Tell me about the laws and how they personally affected your family. You mentioned something about the store, your father's store. What other things did you see?
Well, since I left fairly early, I left in August 38, and Hitler marched in March. When I left, my father still had the store. We still had the apartment. Right after I left, all that was taken away from them. They had to move into a coal bin in the basement with other Jewish families from other buildings. And so I didn't see that part of it. The way I got out was that I went to the various consulates and looked into telephone books about people of my own name, Harmel. Harmel is not a common name. And at the American consulate, I found 5 people by that name in phone books in New York, Cleveland, and Washington. And I wrote letters to them. And at that time, I was 16 years old. And I wrote 5 letters telling them that I hope that they know the situation in Austria, that I was a Jewish girl, that I had good grades in school, and that I was healthy, and I need help. All I need is an affidavit of support. I don't need any money. I have enough money for fare, and I have enough clothes, and that I won't bother them or be a burden to them, but I need an affidavit of support in order to get a visa and the permission to come to the United States. And by return mail, I had 3 affidavits, which was nothing short of a miracle. And they either thought that we were really related or manufactured a relationship for the benefit of the United States State Department. And it became like a reunification of a family. And I then had a visa and an affidavit to come to the United States. However, the quota number was so high that I had to wait, and I couldn't actually get the permit to leave. I had to wait till my quota number was up. And I would have had to wait so long, it would have been too late. So I forced my way into the consulate in Vienna after standing in line all night long, and something like 14 hours. And by that time, I was so overwrought that I screamed at the man who was at the door and pushed him aside and ran up the stairs and got into a room and started to cry. And a woman came in and asked me why I was crying. And this, it's a long story, but she happened to be the wife of the general counsel of the American, of the United States. She then ushered me into his office. They didn't speak any German. And somehow I made them understand that my parents were about to leave for Cyprus and that I refused to go because I didn't want to go to Israel. I was not a Zionist. I only wanted to go to the United States, and I had a visa and I had an affidavit, and can't they hurry it up and let me get out, because I was going to be left all alone. My parents were about to leave and I didn't want to be left alone in Vienna. So the consul got an interpreter and told me that a friend of his was coming in to Vienna and I should write him a letter. He gave me the name. His name was Alfred Jaretsky. He didn't tell me who he was. He just said, he's a man that's coming from New York. Write to him and he may be able to help you. He says, send a letter to me and he may help you. And 2 days later, we had a telephone call that Mr. Jaretsky indeed was in Vienna and wanted to see me. Oh, I thought we'd turn it off. And, sorry about that.
Who was he with, Mr. Jaretsky?
Mr. Jaretsky? He was, I didn't know that at the time.
And so who was he with? I'm sorry.
He happened to be head of the Joint Distribution Committee in New York, which I didn't know. And after he saw me and we talked to each other, he introduced me to a young woman whose name was Ruth Fellner. And she was head of the Jewish Children's Refugee Committee in London at the Woburn House. And they said, would you like to come to England and wait for your visa to come through in England? And I said, yes, but I can't go to England. He says, we'll arrange that. And miraculously, they arranged overnight to get the visa to go to England. And I flew on a Czech plane with Mr. Jaretsky to London 2 days later. My parents didn't want to let me go because they thought he might be a white slaver. But they made inquiries at the Jewish Kultusgemeinde, which is the cultural organization, Jewish organization in Vienna. And they said, it's perfectly all right. He is with the Joint Distribution Committee and your daughter is safe and very lucky to be able to go with him.
What did you have to pay him to get over?
My parents donated money to him for the cause of helping other people in my plight or their plight. And we didn't have to pay. This was a voluntary action on my parents' part, because at that time they had all the money that you would need. And they bought me a ticket on the Normandy with an open departure. First-class ticket on the Normandy from London to New York with departure open. So he took me to England. We arrived in London, and there was Miss Fellner, who took me to Woburn House and made arrangements for me to live in a boarding house in London.
I'd like to stop right there and go back to that. I wanted to find out a couple things. When you were in Austria, did you ever see any book burnings and anything like that?
Oh, yes. That was very common. There were mountains of book piled in the courtyard right where I lived, and they burnt books in major public places. We were caught on the street many times and had to scrub swastikas off the sidewalk.
Who would?
There were always gangs of SA youths. They were young people in these brown and red uniforms. And they would just catch you and make you do things. And I did that twice, while other people walked by and screamed at you or spit at you or laughed. And it was absolutely horrible. But nothing compared to what other people went through.
But how did you feel?
How does one feel? Terrible. Terrible. The only thing that saved me, and I must say that's probably the best thing, according to my aunts and uncle, I was a very spoiled brat. My parents thought that I was God's gift to this earth, and that helped me. I knew that I was all right and that they were wrong, and it didn't break my spirit. And I think that was because my parents made me feel that way. Nobody could hurt me. I did not lose my self-esteem.
What were your parents telling you during this time?
My father kept saying it's going to blow over. And they thought in the beginning that I was a hysterical teenager and I was making too much of it. My father says, I was born here, I was in the war, I was an ardent Austrian, I was patriotic. How can anything happen to me?
Do you know what your father did during World War I?
He was a soldier. I don't know too much about it.
Did he ever receive any special favors because he was in the military?
No, nobody got favors. I mean, the defeat was so tremendous that it was a miracle that any of them survived. The battles were so terrible, especially on the border of Italy, that at the last moment, from what I have heard, they took 15 and 16-year-old boys and 70-year-old men. I mean, it was called the letzte Aufgebot, the last effort, you know, where they took anybody that could still walk.
I was just wondering if when this was all going on in Austria, because he was in the war, if
no,
anything
he got
was
this
made
good
easier.
Job, you know, as a traffic manager, which was a very good job. But my father was very educated and extremely verbal and personable. So... But he didn't have much common sense when it came to the time.
In what way?
Well, he didn't want to leave.
I'd like to go back a little bit to the Anschluss, what happened to you, and then go on from there.
Well, like I said, my only... occupation at that time was to find a way to get out of Austria. That was a constant quest. It took every day, walking on the streets, being afraid that you would be accosted or taken to jail or murdered or goodness knows what. My mother never knew that I was ever going to come home again after I left in the morning. And I would talk to some other young people that were doing the same thing.
What about your parents? I mean, did they want to go with you or?
No, they there was really no chance for them to go with me. When I got the affidavits, that was only for me because I was young. These people whose name was Harmel, it turned out that they were all related to each other and they knew that the other people had also sent affidavits, and then they combined, and they forwarded their affidavits to a daughter of the man in Washington, whose husband was a famous patent attorney in Chicago, and they had a daughter my age. So they thought it would be perfect if I would come and be a ready-made sister for her. But when we asked, would they bring my parents out, they said no, they didn't want to take the responsibility of older people. And they only wanted to do that for me. Well, as it happened, I left for England in August 38. My parents were left in Vienna. The visa to Cyprus never came through. And then I finally ended up in a foster home of people that were recommended by the Quakers. And they eventually brought my parents out of Austria. They sent for them and they got them to be domestic servants in England. That was the only way that anybody could immigrate to England. You had to be a domestic servant. You couldn't do any other kind of work. And that's how my parents were saved. And they came to England on the last train out of Austria.
When was that?
Before the war, 1939.
When exactly did you leave Austria? What month was that?
August, okay. August 15th.
And you said you left with the gentleman, his name was?
Jaretsky. Came to London, and then I stayed in a boarding house where the Jewish Children's Refugee Committee paid for me to live in that boarding house, which was next door to where Sigmund Freud lived. I had a cousin who was born in England and lived in Austria and also fled, but because she was a British citizen, could get out right away. And they lived in this part of London, in Swiss Cottage. And her husband was a psychiatrist and had studied with Sigmund Freud and was a very close friend of Anna Freud. So he introduced me, and I saw him every day for the few weeks that I lived there when he took a walk on the arm of his daughter, Anna. And at that time, he had a very bad problem with his tongue. I think he had cancer of the tongue, and it was hard for him to speak.
What was the boarding house like, and where was it?
Well, it was in a part called Swiss Cottage, which is a nice part of London. And it had all sort of a motley crew of people living there, and you all had breakfast together. And they served, and I had a tiny, tiny room. And I came to breakfast, and they served this watery-looking coffee, and it was the strangest coffee I ever had. And I said, that is, you know, what is this? And they said it was tea. It was tea with milk. I had never seen that before. So it was all right. I had things to do every day, such as going to the Children's Refugee Committee to see how they would, where they would place me and what they would do with me. And at that time, Chamberlain went to Munich to talk to Hitler. And he came back with Peace in Our Time, you know, the man with the umbrella. And gas masks were handed out to everybody. And the children had to be evacuated out of London. And then I became an evacuee. And Miss Fellner saw to it that I was placed with a nice family in the country after I had spent 3 months with training at a children's nursery. The children's nursery where they put me in training to become a children's nurse was called the Lady Cynthia Mosley Day Nursery. Lady Cynthia Mosley was the dead wife of Sir Oswald Mosley, the English Nazi. And the matron there was so terrible. She told me that Hitler was a wonderful man, and that he was absolutely right in what he was doing to the Jews. And because I had been raised with maids, and I didn't know anything. I didn't know how to iron. I didn't know how to scrub a floor. I didn't know anything. So they thought I was very stupid and very useless. And she said that people like me should be eliminated because I was just a useless creature. So I was so miserable and so unhappy.
What was her name?
I don't remember her name. All I know is I didn't speak English at the time. And in the few weeks that I was there, I went to bed with a dictionary every night just so that I could learn enough to tell her what I thought of her. And I escaped by squeezing myself out through a toilet window. And I had a little diamond ring that I gave to a greengrocer across the street, so he gave me car fare. And I went to the Jewish Refugee Committee, and I saw Miss Fellner after waiting for hours, all in my uniform, because I had to wear a uniform, and said, I'd rather go back to Vienna and go to a concentration camp than stay in that nursery, because it's just like a concentration camp. Of course, now that I'm used to scrubbing and cleaning, it wouldn't be so bad, but at that time, I just felt terrible. And I was alone, and I didn't speak English, and all the other young nurses put all the dirty work on me, and everybody was making fun of me because I didn't know anything. So she then turned me over to the Society of Friends, the Quakers, and they found me a foster home in the country because they wanted to get me out of London by then.
When you were in the boarding school, how many people were there?
In the boarding house?
I mean, in the boarding house.
I don't remember, maybe 10. It was like a little bed and breakfast place.
Did you have your own room? Or?
Yes, I had my own room. I had a tiny little room. And I had 7 suitcases. And my mother packed in a hurry because I only had 2 days when Mr. Jaretsky got me the visa. So she packed. I had 7 formals because she thought that they were dressed for dinner in England. And 30 pairs of underpants, but nothing really useful. So I had all the wrong things with me. And that's how I came to that boarding house.
What was the nationality of the people in the boarding house?
I really don't remember. I don't remember. Don't forget, I couldn't communicate.
Yeah. How long were you there?
About 3 weeks.
When you left Austria, what did you recall saying to your parents?
My parents didn't want to let me go. It was a tremendous struggle to make them let me go. And we took a taxi to the airport. None of us had ever been on an airplane before. This was in 1938. People weren't flying very much. Neither one of us said anything. We just kissed and hugged and I remember looking out the window of the plane and seeing them get smaller and smaller. Anyway, it's so long ago, but it feels like yesterday. And then I was so enthralled with the idea of flying, and it was so beautiful to be above the clouds, and it was exciting. Everything was an adventure after that.
What type of communication did you have with your parents when you were in England?
When I was in England, I could telephone them and write to them. And they sent me postal money orders so I could get a little money out of it and pocket money. And then, of course, I was lucky enough to have them come later on. And the people in England, my foster homes, were very wonderful people. And they were very nice to me. But I had to move 18 times because none of them thought I would be there. It was, I had a transit visa for 3 months, but my to England. But my American visa didn't come through because the war broke out. And during the war, there was no way of getting across. But I left in November 1939. The war had broken out in September. So I went on a French ship. By that time, the Normandy was sinking in New York Harbor. It was tilting. And the French line didn't want to give me any passage. They said that the ticket that I had, the money was in Vienna, and they never got that money. The refugee committee then supplied me with a lawyer, and they fought and said, you got the money out right away, which they did. And they gave me passage on the smallest French line ship, the De Grasse, instead of the largest. And it was a blacked-out ship, all painted gray, with guns mounted on the decks. And it was a gun runner, really. And it took 21 days to come across the Atlantic while mines were swept loose and U-boats attacked. We were under constant U-boat attack. Then we got to New York Harbor safely. And again, I had to leave my parents behind, because by then they were as domestic servants in a home of a colonel close to where I lived. And I got them that position, which turned out to be a very bad idea, because my parents were then considered German nationals, and they were working for an English colonel. And the colonel got in trouble because they were employing German nationals, so my father was arrested. And taken to a camp on the Isle of Man, and then later on my mother was arrested, and they both were in different camps on the Isle of Man, and the only communication they had with me was when I was in the States already, was by the mail, which was just a letter of 11 lines that they sent to me, and then I could write to them and tell them where the other was. They didn't know about each other.
What was V-mail?
V-mail was a letter that was censored, and it was on one page and could only be 11 lines long. And most of that they cut out. It was always censored.
When you were in, I'd like to go back a little bit and maybe pick up some more details. When you were in the foster homes, do you recall any of the people that you were with?
Oh, yes, of course, of course.
Tell me about that.
My first foster home was with people by the name of Rose Veer. They were, he was, had just joined the Quakers. And
okay.
They had just come back from having been in Burma for 17 years, where he was a civil engineer.
What I'm going to be doing here, I'm going to be stopping right here. We're going to be going on to the next tape. This is tape 3, interview with Hilda Pieris. Hilda, you were talking about foster homes, and you were giving me some of the names of where you stayed and what it was like. So why don't we go back to there?
Well, after I escaped from the children's nursery in Kennington Oval in London, I was brought to a lovely family in Sussex, in the country, which is south of London. And the lady, Mrs. Marjorie Rosevere, hugged me and kissed me, and I was so afraid to be taken out of London, because I said, how will I escape? How will I know where to run or where to go? But after I met her, I was perfectly at ease, and I was with them for 3 months. They had a daughter my age. Her name was Brenda. And my foster, they asked me to call them aunt and uncle, and I did. And my uncle died at age 80, and my foster mother, Marjorie, is now 103 years old, and I go to visit her every 2 years and sent them food packages all through the war, and we're very close. And that's really my family. And then they, when their son was coming home from college, they needed the room and sent me to a cousin of theirs, Muriel Blakey, in a little village near the one I lived in, which was Cupthorne. And then I stayed with this other family, and they took in seven evacuee children out of London, and I helped take care of them. And there was a pair of twins, and the little runt of the litter, Freddie, absolutely adored me. And subsequently, years later, I saw them again when they were gray-haired men. And I remember he came to us from London, and he had a running ear. He had an ear infection. And after not seeing him for 30 years, or no, 40 years, the first thing I said to him, how is your ear? He says, you know, it still bothers me.
During this time, did you go to school or?
No, I had private tutors. They didn't send me to school. I really don't know why they didn't. I guess they couldn't. But they sent me to lessons, and I took shorthand lessons and painting lessons, and I was taught English watercolor methods. And we went to concerts, and I learned a lot about music, and they corrected my English, and every second word I asked, how do you spell that? So I never went to school, but I picked up English and became fluent and can write flawlessly without ever having learned it at school, just because they corrected me and they gave me fairy tales to read where I knew the story, and learned to read and write English that way.
Who supported you during this time in terms of the food and?
Well, the foster families fed me and housed me, and I had little money that my parents sent. Then my aunt and uncle in Israel sent me a little money, very little. I'm really surprised that they were as stingy as they were. They sent me very little money, and I didn't need anything. I really didn't need anything. I had everything, and I painted Christmas cards. The people that I lived with, the Blakeys, were very devout and very religious in the Church of England, and they had a women's club, and they sold my Christmas cards. What I didn't realize is this is at the height of the war, and I was painting little Austrian boys and girls in lederhosen, and that was the enemy, but they still bought my Christmas cards that were hand-painted. I would cut little windows out, like little Austrian cottages with flower boxes and things like that, and that's how I supported myself, make pocket money. And I was teaching German to a few people. I mean, they were so kind. This was during the war, mind you, with Germany, the enemy, and they did that for me. So they were just wonderful. I really renewed my faith in humanity after that.
How did the war affect you during this time?
Well, it affected me because the planes were overhead, and we lived right near Gatwick Airport, which is now a commercial airport. At that time, it was an army airport, and there were no bombings when I was there. The major bombings and V2 rockets came after I left. My parents experienced all of that, but I didn't. I was afraid because from early childhood on, I always learned about gas wars and about poison gas and stuff like that, so I was deathly afraid of the war. But I didn't want to leave England. I wanted to stay there, but when my visa came through in November 1939, my parents insisted that I go to America, that I don't stay there, although I really didn't want to leave. And that's when I left. What I didn't tell you before was in Vienna, when Hitler marched in, the Nazis took over my grandparents' farm. My grandmother was forced to leave the little town where they lived in her beautiful house and moved in with my aunt and uncle in Vienna.
Can you give me their names again?
My grandmother, Therese Kohn, and my aunt Camilla Kohn, Grünwald. And both of them subsequently died in a concentration camp in Poland, in Lublin. And I don't know what year. I wrote to them. Saying goodbye to my grandmother was also very hard. And none of us really said very much. I mean, they didn't say good luck or anything. We just kissed and cried, and she put a bracelet on my arm that was a very beautiful bracelet with diamonds and rubies, which was subsequently stolen in New York, I mean, in Chicago. But we didn't really need any words. We all knew what it was like and that we might never see each other again. Of course, I didn't know that they would take that poor little old lady. That poor little old lady was a year younger than I am now, but she was really an old lady. And dragged her into concentration camp, and I just hoped that she died on the way.
Who was the uncle? You said that they moved in with your uncle.
My uncle, his name was Ignaz Grünwald, and he also was taken to concentration camp. They had one son who was a doctor and was able to get to America with his wife with great difficulties. And we had hoped that he would be able to get his parents out in time, but he wasn't able to. And my mother's brother fled to Uruguay, and I thought that he could help my grandmother.
What was his name?
His name was Rudolf Kohn, and changed his name to Cuny. And he didn't, he wasn't able to bring my grandmother out. I was able, at age 17, to bring out my parents and a girlfriend from Vienna. But my grown-up uncle and cousins couldn't do anything. They tried, they said, but they didn't try hard enough. My constant striving was to help my parents. There was not one moment of any day that I didn't think of how I could get them out, and I didn't stop asking anybody and everybody, can you help my parents?
You said that you came out with a cousin?
No, I came out with this Mr. Jaretsky.
Oh, okay, because you mentioned something about a cousin that also immigrated.
My mother's sister's son Yeah, he came separately, okay. And I don't okay. even know when he left or how. That was after I left.
Okay. What was his name?
His name was Erich Grünwald, Eric, okay. and okay. he changed it to Gordon.
Okay.
And, after I left and I was in England and the war broke out, I mean, there were really total lapses. I had no contact with any of my family. And then when I came to the United States, my parents were in internment camp. So all those things are not as clear as they might be, and it's so long ago.
I wanted to go back when you were in Austria. Regarding school, we never really covered it. Like, what type of subjects did they teach you, being that you said there were just two Jewish people in your classes?
Right. Well, we had 13, so we carried 13 subjects. And we had professors, and each period, I guess, was an hour long, and you started school at 8 in the morning until 1 in the afternoon. And we had religion, which was the first subject on the report card. And because there were so few Jews, we had to go to a different school on Wednesday afternoon where Jewish children came from all over Vienna and had religious instruction by a rabbi professor. And we learned to read ancient Hebrew and biblical history. And we got a grade. And if you didn't pass, we could flunk. We also had to attend services once a week in a Jewish temple, and I mentioned that. My favorite subjects were geography and history, and German composition. I enjoyed writing essays, and we had physics and chemistry and all the subjects that the children have in high school here, except that we were that much younger. We started at age 10. High school was at age 10.
At any time in Austria, did the non-Jewish people try to help you or your family?
Never. Not once, never.
Did your family ever ask?
You didn't ask. Because you knew that if they helped you, that they might be in danger. There was one neighbor. It was a peculiar building. People lived there from the time they were born. And there were a lot of artists living in that building. We had a very famous sculptor by the name of Zalesny. We had a painter of religious art by the name of Kempf. And the emperor came to that building, and we had a statue of Emperor Franz Joseph I in the garden because he came to visit the artists. And it was a very famous building. And one man who was a colonel in the Austrian army, and he walked very stiffly as if he had swallowed a broomstick, never spoke to us because they were very anti-Semitic, never even greeted us, and just walked past us from time immemorial, and we just took it for granted that Oberst Stumpfwohl just was like that. When I left, when I was packing, and the suitcases were outside our door, this stiff man walked past and started to talk to us. For the first time since my father was born in that building, this man had lived right above us and never spoken. And he said, "Forgive us because we do not know what we do." And that's what he said. So that was the only should I say kind word that we ever experienced.
What were you thinking when he said that?
I was amazed, absolutely amazed. We all were. And subsequently, my parents told me that they always greeted them and said hello and good morning when it was really dangerous to do these things.
Are there any other things that you recall that happened to you personally when you were in Austria, maybe that I've not asked?
I really can't recall anything that is of particular great interest, except that we were so busy trying to save our skin. I mean, you're so busy, this is your total preoccupation all day long, is where can I walk that's not dangerous? How can we get money out of the bank? How can we get dressed? How can we get food? Would the grocers sell us food? Would our maids quit? The help in the stores quit? Nobody wanted to work for us anymore. We were afraid that somebody would inform against us for some crazy reason. I mean, you couldn't trust anyone. I don't know what else to tell you. That's really how it was when I was there.
How did you get food?
That wasn't really my job. That was my mother's job. I was so busy with running around to different consulates and trying to get visas or getting out and writing letters and trying to learn English. Oh, and I forgot, my mother enrolled me in a cooking school and in a hat factory so that I should learn a profession when I left the country, that I would know how to do some things. And that's all we did. And, you know, at that age, I was 16 years old, what does one really know?
How, with all this happening, how did you feel being a Jew?
Well, I think I would have liked not to have been a Jew. Of course. It would have been easier not to. I often asked myself that question. I have come to the conclusion that I was happier being a victim than a persecutor, because I don't know what I would have done if I had not been a Jew, how I would have reacted. And I might have been afraid of the reactions, because I felt that the people who didn't actively hurt anybody and just looked on were just as guilty. So I felt that life was made easier for me being a victim.
Let's go back now to when you were going to the United States. Tell me, when was that again?
Well, I left England on Armistice Day, and leaving England during the war from Southampton Harbor was not an easy matter. The woman that I lived with, this Muriel Blakey, took me by train to Southampton, and it was one of these terribly foggy days that you only see in a Sherlock Holmes movie. You couldn't see your hand in front of your face. We got to Southampton, and there was, you just couldn't see anything. And I had to get on a train and leave my friend and say goodbye to her. And in the excitement, she was holding my raincoat, and I didn't have a coat. I left that behind. I got on the train, the boat train, to the harbor. And there I got off the train and got onto a tender somehow in this thick fog. And suddenly, out of the fog rose this great big hull of a gray ship. And we had to go up on a rope ladder. And that was very difficult. The rope ladder was swaying, and then the ocean below, and it was really scary. And we got up on the ship, and there were guns all over and sandbags all over. And I got into my cabin, and it was a cabin that was as big as my living room here. It was enormous and very beautiful. And it was a very luxurious looking ship inside. And a person knocked on my door, and he said, Miss Harmel, he said, we would like you to sell poppies on the ship, Armistice Day poppies. And I says, oh, I would be delighted. And he said, you're English, aren't you? I said, no, I'm not. I'm stateless, because my passport had expired, and I didn't want to get a German passport. So I refused to go to the German consulate to renew my passport, and the British gave me a certificate of, I forgot the correct wording, but it was a a certificate that I was stateless and that I was leaving Britain in good standing, and I was coming to America. So when he found out that I was not English, I couldn't sell poppies, but because we were at war at the time with Germany. So then there were tremendous storms. It was November, and the storms were tremendous, and I always felt the ship was going to break in half. And like I said, mines had been swept loose, and U-boats were attacking, and we could hear the guns going off. But they told us it was target practice. In the middle of the ocean, it was target practice.
How many people were on the ship?
That's hard to tell because it was so stormy. Most of them were sick, so nobody came to the dining room. I was in the dining room alone, but it was a big ship. It was 26,000 tons.
What was the name of it again?
De Grasse. And it sank shortly thereafter on one of the trips. Going back, you see, it was carrying arms from America to France, and it was sunk.
Now, you said you left and said goodbye to a friend. What was her name?
Muriel Blakey. That was the cousin of the Roseveres that I was living with.
So when exactly did you arrive in the U.S., and how old were you?
I was 18, and I arrived at the end of November, 1939.
How did you pay for your transport?
I explained to you that my parents had bought the passage in Vienna on the Normandy, and the French line eventually made good and gave me the passage on the De Grasse. All I was allowed to take out of England was $5. And I came with $5 in my purse. And with that, I bought roses for my telephone book aunt in New York.
What other things did you bring with you? Clothes?
Well, I had all those formals. And underwear.
So where did you go from there? What was the first place that you went, and what happened?
The first place that I went was the telephone book Carmels from New York. They had two sons, and one is Dr. Merrill Harmel, who is a famous anesthesiologist in at Duke University, now retired, and his brother, Richard Harmel, who just died very recently. And his parents, Lou and Hermine Harmel, they were not related, really. I found them in the telephone book. And they met me at the dock when I arrived, except they didn't meet me at the dock. I had sent a telegram that I was arriving, but the telegram was censored. So they cut out the date. And so they didn't know when I would arrive. And nobody gave them the information. So when when the ship docked, well, first I want to tell you, it was again very foggy when we passed the Statue of Liberty. And that was so thrilling, you know, to see the Statue of Liberty, that everybody was on deck at that time. And when we arrived in New York Harbor, all kinds of reporters came on deck from the newspapers. And there were articles, and there were even articles in Chicago about that I arrived, because it was a ship chased by submarines all the way across. And everybody had somebody waiting for them at the ship, except me. And I was there till about 7 o'clock at night, and nobody came. And I'm sitting there with 7 suitcases alone in the dark at the dock, and nobody came. And I finally found the phone number of my uncle in one of my suitcases and called, and they lived in Brooklyn, and I had to wait another hour before he and his son Merrill came to pick me up. And they came in that great big car, and the radio was playing in the car, and it was Toscanini conducting the Ninth Symphony, and we went over the Brooklyn Bridge, and it was so beautiful. And I stayed with them for 3 weeks, and then my telephone book uncle from Chicago. I was in New York on business, and I went back by train with him to live in Chicago. And their name was Schneider, Benjamin Schneider. And I lived with them for several months until I found a place of my own and a job.
What did you do?
I was an apprentice to a dress designer at a dress factory in Chicago. And it was my aim to become a dress designer because I liked to draw, and I thought all I would have to do is draw pretty pictures. What I didn't realize is that a dress designer had to make patterns and be a dressmaker, and I didn't like that part of it. And that's where I met my first husband, who was a salesman. And
what was his name?
His name is Charles Rubin. And I was married to him for 28 years, and we had a wonderful daughter. And the way I met him was the man I worked for. Of course, I asked him, would you give me affidavits for my parents? That was my constant quest. You know, I asked everybody I met. He says, no. He says, I'm dead broke. I can hardly pay my bills. He says, but I know a bachelor who is a very nice person, and maybe he'll do it for you. So he set up a lunch date for me with Charlie. And he was 34 years old at the time, and I was 18. And we had lunch, and I told him my problem, that I needed someone to guarantee for my parents. And he said he'll be glad to do it. So we went to the Hayas and the Hebrew Aid Society to make out the papers for my parents. Well, they found out that he didn't make enough money and didn't have enough money because all he owned was $800 and a car that he was making payments on. So they said, you can't guarantee for two people except if you were married. So I said to him, would you marry me? He said, I won't hold you to it, you know, we'll just get married and I'll pay for that. And then when my parents come over, we get divorced. So this was the first day I met him. And I said, you know, it'll only be pro forma. It's just a legal thing. And there was a movie after that, long time afterwards, Green Card. You know, that's really my story. And he said, all my life I've been wanting to marry a girl like you. He said, of course we'll do it. So, and subsequently we got married, and it was a very good marriage. And my parents came over after my daughter was 9 months old. They came over in 1943 on a convoy with 21 ships, 12 of which were sunk. And Churchill was making a speech at that time, saying, as I'm speaking, a convoy is being attacked in the Atlantic. And I just knew that was the convoy my parents were on because they had sent a letter, we're leaving soon. And I knew that that's meant that they were leaving. So that was very exciting when they finally came and were alive and called from New York and came to Chicago, and I had a 9-month-old baby girl.
What was your daughter's name?
My daughter's name is Diana.
And what about school? Did you go back to school at any time?
Yes, I went to the Art Institute of Chicago. I was married and I went to school. I never graduated, unfortunately, because we moved. At that time it was difficult to get apartments and all that, so we moved to a suburb.
So how much schooling, how long did you go there?
I went there for 2 years on and off, and then subsequently took lots of courses in art and art history.
I'm going to stop right here. We're going to be going on to tape 4. Thank you. Okay. Hilda, you were talking about going to art school. Before we go to that, I'd like to find out, when did you find out what happened to your family? What did you find out, the ones that were left in Austria?
Well, after the war was over, we had the news that, we didn't really have any news. We just didn't hear from anybody. We kept asking various agencies to help us to try to find traces of our relatives, and everybody was gassed. So we subsequently found out that my grandmother and aunt and uncle died in Lublin, where my other relatives died, some in other camps, I really don't know.
How did you find this out?
I went to Vienna and found out because I was looking for them, and they had records of my aunt and uncle and my grandmother.
Where were the records?
The records were in some official office in Vienna. I don't remember exactly where, but in some government office. And they told us it was Lublin.
Anybody else?
Yes, cousins who lived in Czechoslovakia.
Their names?
My little cousin was Walter Cohn, and his mother, Shari, and a number of other cousins.
How did you feel being in Austria? And when did you go back?
We went back in 1949, the first time. I enjoyed seeing the destruction. All around the building where I lived was rubble, and the opera was in rubble, and I enjoyed that. I felt they deserved it, and that was the right thing. And we went back to the building where I lived and saw some of our former neighbors, and they said, "Do you see what they did to us?" And I said, "What they did to you?" They said, "Isn't it terrible? Look at the destruction and the rubble and everything." I said, "Well, what do you think you did to us?" But I loved going back and seeing my hometown, and had this love-hate relationship. You know, it's very hard to describe.
You said you've been there since?
Yes, I've been there several times, because my aunt came from Israel, and I still have cousins that went from Israel back to live in Vienna, which I can hardly understand, but they are living there. In fact, one second cousin, a young man, is working for the Austrian government and has a very high position, married to a Gentile girl.
What is his name?
His name is Ilan Fellman.
Okay, let's go back now. You were talking about school. What did you do with your art education?
Well, I at first was what they derogatively called a housewife artist. I went to art school, and I went to art classes, and I started exhibiting at art fairs and started selling my work. And I lived in a small suburb of Chicago called Highland Park, Illinois. And they had a newspaper, the Highland Park News, and they were desperate for news. So they used to call me and ask me, "Did you win any prizes? Did you do anything lately? Did you go on any trips or anything like that?" So I would always get write-ups. And then the YWCA asked me if I would to teach art classes there, and I did. And I taught classes for children and adults. And it got so that my husband said, "If that Highland Park News writes you up one more time, I'm going to cancel the subscription." But it was very good, and they really helped make me into a professional artist. I forgot to tell you that when I was in Vienna, and I was always good at drawing and painting, at age 10, we had a contest for Halloween, to do a picture of Halloween. Now, Halloween in Austria, in a Catholic country, is a Catholic holiday. And it's All Saints and All Souls Day. And everybody goes to the cemetery in processions with lanterns and beautiful wreaths of flowers. And our maids were always Catholic, and they would take me. As a child, from the time I was very little, they would take me to the major cemetery, and there would be all these flower ladies and with the beautiful wreaths and sitting there with the umbrellas. And I painted a picture of that, the great big wall of the cemetery with the huge statuary peeking over the wall with crosses of the graves and the wreaths of flowers. And then I said, gee whiz, I'm Jewish. Why do I paint all those crosses? So in addition to the crosses, I put Mogen Dovids on every grave. And I won first prize in the city of Vienna because at that time it was a socialist government and they saw the humor in it. So after that, I thought I had to become an artist.
Now, you said you have one daughter, and what is her name again?
Diana, and I have one granddaughter, Melissa. Okay. And I have two wonderful step-grandsons. One is brand new. His name is Noah Sutton Smolin. And I have another six-year-old, Max, and we're very close.
When did you leave Chicago?
I left Chicago in 1975 and moved to Laguna Beach.
What type of things do you enjoy doing in your spare time?
Well, I don't really have any spare time. I paint, and for the last 7 years, I've been working for Carnival Cruise Lines, doing murals and paintings for the ships. And I have a new commission for a new ship coming out in 1998 or 1997, late 97 or 98, and it'll be called the Elation. And I'm going to do 20 murals, which is 60 large panels. And I do abstracts for them.
How would you describe your religious affiliation today?
None. We have tried. We've joined a temple, and we have gone to a meeting of the Jewish Humanistic Society, and none of it really has fit my husband and me. We have divergent opinions, and we haven't really settled on anything yet. He is more traditional than I am.
Have you belonged to any synagogues? Or?
Yes, I have. A number of them, especially when my daughter was little. And she hated Sunday school so much, we had to change temples.
Tell me about your husband. When were you married, your current husband?
We were married 2 years ago, and very happily so. And I consider myself very fortunate.
And what is his name?
And his name is Herman Slutsky. And he is just the most wonderful person in the world.
And where is he from?
He was born in Chicago and lived most of his life in Mattoon, Illinois, a small town outside of Chicago, near the University of Chicago, and came to California, I think, in 1973 with his first wife, who died several years ago, about the same time when my second husband died.
And what was his name?
My second husband was named Norman Pierce, and he was a radio and TV announcer in Chicago.
What was the reason that you wanted to tell your story today?
Well, the major reason really was as a legacy for my family. And we were very recently, just 2 weeks ago, in China and on a cruise. And we met a man there who lectured on his experience as a refugee in Shanghai. And his name is Fred Marcus, and he had given witness and made a tape and asked me if I would be interested. And that's how it came about.
Why do you think you survived? I mean, what made you keep on going, obviously, during Austria and since then?
Well, you know, you may have heard about survivor's guilt. That's a big question. Why did I survive? I don't know. I really don't know. I was just lucky.
What made you keep going?
Oh, what made me keep going? Well, first of all, I was very young. And I had a tremendous sense of wanting to live. And I was just fortunate that in my various endeavors, I had these miraculous results, which were really something that nobody could foretell. Because I was so fortunate in meeting the American consul and meeting Mr. Jaretsky and meeting the people in England that helped my parents out and saved their lives, and then coming to the States and having telephone book relatives helping me and meeting these wonderful men that I was married to.
How do you feel about the way you lived your life and what's important to you?
That's a very difficult question. I'm not prepared for that. I should have more time to think about that. What's important to me is to be as good a person as I can be and to have mores that are important and try to be an important, good citizen of the United States and help out where I can.
How did your experiences in Austria affect you?
It affects every moment of every day that I live. I can never forget and I can never forgive. I had experiences in Austria when I went back to study with Oskar Kokoschka, who is a very famous artist, in Salzburg, Austria, where I met with anti-Semitism and Nazis all over again in 1962. And I'm just thrilled to death that I don't have to live there with these people that I can never forgive and who really have never changed.
Do you think about it often?
All the time. It's with me all the time.
Do you ever dream about it?
When I was married the first time in 1941, for 10 years I used to wake up screaming at night. I dream about it very seldom now.
What would you dream?
Well, lately all I've been dreaming is about the trials and tribulations of my granddaughter who has become a hippie.
And what about when in your nightmares?
And that's what I dream about.
Yeah.
And the problem of the young people in America, and I'm dreaming about the presidential election and fighting.
What about when you were dreaming, when you had your nightmares, what would you dream about?
The Hitler experience of being caught, of confronting Hitler, and would I have the nerve to kill him? And that was a constant dilemma in my dreams. What would I do if I met him? And subsequently, I had these dreams in Laguna Beach when we were living so close to Nixon. What would I do if I met him on the beach?
Have there been any decisions that you made as a result of your experience in Austria?
My whole life is a decision of the experience that I had. I mean, you can't divorce yourself from that. Everything is a decision about that. I don't own a German car. I don't own a German thing. I don't buy anything German. I don't like to speak German, although I love the language. I'm not kindly disposed toward anything German.
What about the way you raised your daughter?
My daughter was a very young child when she heard about the terrible things that happened. When the Eichmann trial was on in Israel, she saw these television programs and she says, "That didn't really happen, Mother. Did it really? Was that really true? Could that really be true?" she tried to be in total denial about it. She didn't want to hear about it. She doesn't want to know anything about it. It hurt her so much when she was little about seeing us crying about my grandmother and my aunts and my relatives, that she was very damaged by that.
What is her religious affiliation?
None.
It's been over 50 years.
Yes.
Since your experiences.
More than that.
Yeah. What message would you like to leave for your daughter, your grandchild, and anybody that is watching this tape?
My message is that you just keep loving each other and remember me.
Is there anything else that you would like to add?
No, just that I am so extremely lucky that I have this wonderful husband who supports me emotionally tremendously. And I just feel so lucky, both in my profession and my life and my family, and my husband's children are wonderful, and we're very close with them. So I'm really one of the most fortunate people in the world. So, and I don't feel like I'm 75 years old.
We want to thank you very much. What we're going to be doing now is showing your photographs and bringing your husband on.
Thank you.
Hilda. All right, can you introduce me to your husband, please?
This is Herman Slutsky, my beloved.
How do you do?
Good. Is there anything, Hilda, that you would like to say to your husband?
I don't know what you want me to say.
Anything that you would like to share with him?
Well, I think listening to the tape was interesting to you, too, because you really never heard anything like that in detail before. So, in a way, this was also for you.
Thank you. It was a revisit for me, too. Much of the deep detail.
What's it been like living with each other and obviously living with Hilda?
Well, it's I'm the counterpart of what she said as far as I'm concerned. I feel the same way about her as she does me, and we've been very fortunate to find each other. And she's the love of my life, and we enjoy life every day, make the most of it.
Anything else that you would like to say to your husband?
Well, speak a little louder.
We want to thank you very much, and what we're going to be doing here is showing the photographs of your family.
Wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
My grandfather, Adolf Kohn, the picture was taken in 1921. And behind him is the picture of my grandmother, Therese Schlesinger Kohn. And she was a woman that never heard a fly.
And the country?
Who died in concentration camp. They were both born in what is now Czechoslovakia and lived in this small town outside of Vienna. Austria. I don't remember the name of the girl on the left.
Where are you?
I'm the second from the left. This was the occasion of a children's ball in Vienna in 1929. And my cousin Fritz Fellmann is the Pierrot next to me. And then my best friend Nora Reisinger, who was in several camps during the war, is next to my cousin Fritz. The two children on the end, I think one was Lise Reif on the left, and the boy on the right, I don't remember his name.
And what is your name, first and last, please?
My name, Hilda Pierce.
And when was
At that time, it was Hilda Harmel.
And this was taken what year?
In 1929 in Vienna. My mother on the left, her name is Evelyn Harmel, née Kohn. I'm in the middle, the fat one. And my father, Julius, to my right.
And what is your first and last name?
Hilda Hertha Harmel at the time. And this was taken in 1930 when I was 9 years old.
City and country.
In Vienna, Austria. They put me on a stool so that we're all the same height. This is a picture taken in the schoolyard, which was more like a prison yard in Vienna, and it was called Heidenrealschule in the 5th district. I'm the third one on the right, third in from the right.
What is your first and last name?
Hilda Hertha Harmel. And my homeroom professor, Dr. Schubert, and next to him in the dark suit, the school principal, Dr. Maschek, both of whom became very ardent Nazis.
What year was this taken?
1935. This is my first and last Austrian passport. It was dated 1934, and it expired in 1939, and after that I became stateless. And the name there is Hilda Harmel. My aunt and uncle, Camilla Grünwald and Engineer Grünwald, Jakob Grünwald, they both perished in concentration camps. And this was a picture taken in 1938 before I left Vienna. This is the picture that saved my life. I sent this picture to America asking for affidavits. It was taken in 1938 after Hitler annexed Austria.
And your first and last name, please.
At that time, Hilda Hertha Harmel. This is my wedding picture in 1941. Hilda Harmel, then Reuben, and my first husband, Charles Reuben.
Where was it taken?
It was taken in Chicago, and we were married in Hannibal, Missouri. We eloped. I was widowed in 1969 and met Norm Pierce, who is on my left. And this is a picture just before we were married in 1970.
And your name, please?
Norm Pierce and Hilda Pierce. This is my daughter, Diana. Diana Ray Reuben Daly. And my only child, taken in 1975.
Where was it taken?
In New York. She was working there. This is my foster mother in England on her 100th birthday, and she's still alive. She's 103 and sharp as a tack.
When was it taken?
This was taken in 1993 when I visited her.
And her name?
Her name is Marjorie Rose Veer. My wedding picture, January 11th, 1994, Rabbi Rackless on the left, then my husband Herman, my son-in-law Rocky.
What's his last name?
Rocky Smolin, and Max Benjamin, and his wife Marcia, my lovely stepdaughter, the bride, and the ancient bride, my daughter Diana Daly, my granddaughter Melissa Daly, and my son-in-law Everett Daly.
Now, when you're talking about the bride, that is you, and you're wearing the green, and your first and last name, please?
Hilda Pierce.
And what city was country?
This was in Irvine, California. I had this picture taken after I finished my 17 murals for the ship called The Imagination. One of them is behind me. I'm in my garage studio.
And your name, please, first and last?
Hilda Pierce.
And the city and country?
And this was taken in Laguna Niguel, California.
And what year?
1995. Herman and me on board the Crystal Harmony off the coast of Japan, and that was taken 2 weeks ago in 1996.
And who is your first and last name, please?
Hilda and Herman.
And last name?
I still use my name Pierce, my professional name, and Herman Slutsky, my husband.